Welcome back to another episode of the Believe in FCS Football Podcast, part of the Believe Podcast Network. I am Joe DeLeone, joined by my former roommate, former teammate at the University of Rhode Island, Mr. Sean Anderson. Today we're talking round two. We were getting blasted in the comments on YouTube this past week. We got a lot to cover today, Sean, for some of our picks that we made. But Sean, how are you doing?
Not as good as you. Sparky right out of the gate. You know what? I don't like when you do this. I don't like when you do this because when 30 minutes rolls around and then it's okay. Yeah, I agree with that, Sean. Then that's when I start getting the speaking of.
What happens towards the end of the show is like, because we always record, it's 4 o'clock ish my time. What always happens is like we'll record at 4 and I'm not hungry, and then or like around like 5:30 when we finish, I'm usually really hungry and tired. So that's usually the process of decline over a period of time.
Well, it's not like it's 3 hours later here, you know.
You already ate dinner.
How do you know that?
I would just assume so. You're a hungry person.
That's a fake word you just used. A hungry person. Say it with your chest or don't say it at all.
You're a hungry person.
That's not what you
There's
meant to
no
say.
Way that you
That's
would wait
That's not
until
what you meant to say. You are a liar. Say the word that you wanted to say.
Oh, you're fat. My point is that there is no way that you would wait until 8 o'clock to eat dinner. There's absolutely no way that you wouldn't
have eaten
something.
It happens all the time.
Really?
All the time.
Oh, that's disappointing.
I ate my dinner last night, I think, after the first quarter of Sunday Night Football.
I'm apparently an old man because I eat at like 6 o'clock.
Well, we also have very different schedules. You're not up until 2:30 in the morning.
That's true. This is very true. Sean, we got a lot to cover today. The second round was as wild, but for a lot of different reasons, as the first round. And holy crap, the Holy Cross fans came out of the woodwork. We're going to get to that stuff, and we're going to address some of these games, talk about our takeaways. We've got fat stats. Before we get to that, though, Sean, care to discuss with our listeners a little betting? Did you have any bets this week?
I did. Thank you for asking. They went poorly, but it happens.
I had a friendly bet with someone this week. I'm getting closer to actually betting. I lost the friendly bet that I had.
Remember when I was doing the bit of the most annoying guy in the world?
Yeah.
You're becoming that bit. You're becoming it.
Why is that annoying? I technically bet. I made a friendly bet with somebody, and I was I bet that the Raiders would beat Washington, and I was wrong.
You know what this is? This is like somebody that works at Fox Animation Studios, and then he just starts walking around talking like Peter Griffin. That's what it is.
What?
That's what you're doing right now. You're becoming the character.
Oh, F off. Do the read. You pissed me off. Do the read.
Oh, I pissed you off. I didn't realize. Okay, we got Mr. Sensitive tonight.
No.
Well, if you're looking to get in on some action, what do we have, Joe? 5 weeks left of the NFL. That's what I like to bet. We got a ton of NBA left, a ton of MLB left. Oh, never mind. I meant NHL. Way to stay on top of the game in the sporting world, Sean. But if you're looking to bet and you're looking to maybe get a little more excitement on a Monday through Thursday night, why not head to BetOnline? I'm not saying drop down a hunch. I'm saying maybe drop a couple bucks on the game, get you a little more invested. You can just sit there, relax, watch the game. You know, it doesn't have to be a complete sweat show like me in my house. You can just have a good time. Head to the new updated desktop or did it again. Head to the new updated desktop or mobile website to sign up today and receive your 50% welcome bonus on your first deposit. Just use our promo code BLEAV50, BLEAV 50 to receive your bonus from basketball, football, NHL, boxing, and UFC right to your favorite Vegas casino games. Don't wait to take advantage of all the amazing offers available for the 2021 season. BetOnline is the fastest and easiest way to bet all your favorite sports. BetOnline, where the game starts.
Nice little throw in there at the end. Nice. So, folks, we got Christmas coming up, Hanukkah, whatever holiday you might be celebrating this wonderful giving season. And if you've got a loved one in your life and you want to get them something special jewelry wise, I think you need to check out Lightbox Diamonds.
One more time.
What? What did I mean?
I need one more on the jewelry.
What did I say?
There was a misplacement of two letters, I think, in there. I just need one for
jewelry.
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 Okay, there we go.
I don't know what I said the first time.
I got to listen back to the tape. It was wild.
I'm cracking. This has been a rough day for me. For the past couple of days, I've been having some memory problems. I've been having some memory problems the past couple of days. I'm starting to wonder how hard I hit my head when I fell off the scooter.
What do you mean memory problems?
Oh, I just can't remember anything. And I've been like...
What do you mean?
No, I just like I just vaguely can't remember like really simple stuff. But I'm stupid anyways. I'm not a very intelligent person. I already told you I had that issue. Like I forgot my this was before I hit my head. I forgot my my laundry code. But don't be stupid like me, folks. Yeah. Okay. You got to be smart this holiday season if you want to get your girlfriend, your wife something nice. You need to head to Lightbox Jewelry. Say goodbye to dull gifts. Lightbox lab grown diamonds are the brightest gift of the year. Using cutting-edge technology and innovative techniques, they've cracked the science of sparkle, creating the highest quality lab-grown diamonds you can find at a light price, $800 per carat. They have the same chemical makeup of natural diamonds, but just are grown in a lab because of their process. They can create stones in blush pink and beautiful blue, as well as classic white. That is the most awkwardly worded couple of like that should not be a sentence. Lightbox lab grown diamonds are the gift they'll never want to take off price, so they won't have to. They really do make any outfit sparkle. Visit lightboxjewelry.com and add sparkle to your holiday shopping. That's lightboxjewelry.com. Lightbox diamonds never a dull moment. I was so close.
You said diamonds.
diamonds.
Okay, diamonds dull. Okay, yeah. All right, I get how you tripped up. Speaking of diamonds, I need the new Netflix password.
I texted it to you.
He changed it.
I texted it to you.
There was a new one? Oh, I'm
I
sorry.
I texted to you two nights ago.
Oh, my bad. I forgot about that.
Yeah, my brother changed it. I'm like, why did you... I gave Sean our Netflix password for those...
Strictly for Seinfeld. Once I'm done rewatching, I'm out.
Yeah. you keep disrupting my flow because it keeps playing the one that you're on, by the way. But I gave it to Sean and a week later, it gets changed. And I text my brother. I'm like, hey, did you change the password? And he's like, yeah, someone got our password. I'm like, was it in Virginia? And he's like, yeah. I'm like, that was Sean. He's like, oh, he didn't care. But he thought somebody hacked our account. Sean's okay, not smart enough to do that.
Oh, you think I couldn't?
There's no shot. The password was way too complicated for you.
I could get someone to get it.
You don't know anyone that could have done
that.
What
do you mean I don't know? You don't know
smart people?
You don't know who I know.
I know who you know.
You do
I
not.
I know you don't know any smart people. Oh,
that's not true.
That is very true. Sean, I want a quick recap of, speaking of not being smart, I want a quick recap of last week's picks. We both got the Sam Houston victory over Incarnate Word correct. We both got Montana State beating UT Martin correct. Villanova beating Holy Cross. Both of us got that correct. South Dakota State upset over Sac State. Both got that one correct. I mispicked Southern Illinois. You correctly picked North Dakota State in that matchup. We both, and I don't think anyone would have predicted ETSU doing what they did, and we're going to get to that soon. Kennesaw, we both got that wrong. ETSU with the victory. Montana, EWU, I picked Montana right. You incorrectly picked EWU, and then same thing for JMU.
I don't like the way you keep on saying incorrectly regarding me. You're just saying, oh, I got that wrong. It's okay for me.
Wrong and incorrect. You got that incorrect, you bozo.
I don't like your tone when you're saying it because I know how this story ends.
Okay,
you're making it sound like I'm a big doofus.
Before we start talking, well, you're a big doofus. I'm also a big doofus.
What, you're not. You're 5'8".
I am not
5'8".
Okay. Do I need to go get a tape measure?
No, right now? No.
That's what I thought. Current state of the matchups, though, before we recap the action from this past weekend. Sam Houston is going to be battling Montana State, 1-8. Villanova will take on South Dakota State, 5-5 unseeded South Dakota State. 6, Montana versus James Madison. And then North Dakota State versus ETSU, 2-7 in that matchup. So, Sean, we got a lot of wild stuff that happened. And the first one that I want to bring up, because the game was very odd to watch, and I watched a good majority of it, except like when I think I stepped away to like make dinner, and I missed part of it. But the Villanova-Holy Cross game,
oh, did not do it early.
Yeah, it did not play out the way that I came in hot for.
Sure didn't.
But I predicted one thing correctly though, Sean.
Okay.
I said that I came in screaming that Holy Cross didn't belong in this game and they were going to get blown out. And the one thing I called correctly is that out of nowhere, the freaking Holy Cross fans were going to come out of the woodwork again. I don't know where they keep coming from. I didn't know that we had a single Holy Cross fan that listened to the show. I never hear from them. And where did they come from? I don't understand.
Why do you think that somebody wouldn't speak up to defend their team? What if I said on the show right now, I don't enjoy mashed potatoes? What if I said that? What if I said I hate mashed potatoes and every meal that they're at, I want to vomit in my own mouth? What do you think people would say? Mashed potato fans would be coming out of nowhere, everywhere. You know,
I don't know if there's that many passionate mashed potato fans.
Oh, you're living in the wrong state. There's a ton. You've been on the West Coast too long. Regardless, you should have expected it. Okay, you, because college football fans are psychopaths. It's all they care about. There's NFL fans who care about other sports, and then there's non-sports fans, and then there's college football fans. Mm-hmm. That's all they care about. That's their life.
Yeah.
So you have to expect a Holy Cross fan or two to get up in your kitchen.
Right, and they definitely did. But here's one thing I have to say, and Holy Cross fans are not going to like this. I got the sense the whole time throughout this game, and look, Holy Cross proved me wrong. They played a close game, and they played Villanova closer than I've even anywhere near anticipated. But it felt like Villanova was coasting the whole game. It felt like when they needed a big play, they got it really easily. But it felt like they were in a matchup where they knew that they could easily win, and they took them very lightly. And Holy Cross came to fight. I give Holy Cross credit for coming to fight. But they still did not look like they matched up well at all against Villanova. And like, Sean, I compare it to this. When we played Merrimack our senior year, we were not a good football team. Merrimack was terrible. They were a recently elevated Division III program that moved up to Division I. Everyone on that field, we had three NFL guys on that team, knew that we were going to smoke Merrimack. But we played them super lightly, and the game was close for 3.5 quarters, and then we pulled a little bit away at the end. Same concept here for me in my eyes. I saw a much more dominant Villanova team that was coming off of a week off that took Holy Cross very lightly that made this game closer than it would have been. Villanova was going to win this game the whole time. There was no chance in my eyes that I saw that Holy Cross was going to win this football game. Villanova was far more talented, far more dominant. They took them lightly.
So I like what you're saying. It's just the natural skill prevailed is what you're saying, basically.
Yes.
It's that skill prevail.
Yes.
Okay. It is what because on last week, it was you. It was a little different song that you were singing over there, pal.
Well, yeah, because I
don't care about Holy Cross. I have no allegiance there. I have no allegiance. I think it's funny that people were all up in your kitchen. I like that. I like seeing people. I like seeing Joe get grilled. I don't like seeing me get grilled because I preface everything by me saying I don't know anything. Joe still hasn't said that. He still acts like he knows things.
Oh, I know everything, and I at least act like I do.
I said, what did I say last week? That the ETSU hasn't played a triple option team or something like that? They're not ready for
it. Oh,
you
didn't get called out for it?
Yeah, I got called out, and then that tweet had, I don't know, 30 likes?
Wait, did it really?
It blew up. It got sent out. It might only had like 12. I don't know. Maybe I'm exaggerating. It got sent out right before your whole face photo thing, which you.
What about
you? Held up to your end of the bargain with the likes bit as profile picture. That face that you made. Who captured that? Was that Jamie Williams?
It was Jamie, yes. I believe it was Jamie.
Thank you, Jamie. Thank you very much, because I'm not sure how much of our audience is listening or watching on YouTube. That face, I haven't stopped thinking about it because it is so irritating.
Now you get to see it every day.
That you did that while I was trying to speak. And I know that I think the listeners are starting to pick up on it, that this show is just me and Joe sandbagging each other anytime the show starts going well or gaining momentum. We're sadistic. We say, okay, it's going well. Let's just sandbag it and put the air brakes on. That face is the worst sandbag that we've had on this show.
Well, I equate it to, it was like the connection went out on the TV while the broadcast was getting good, like the game's getting good, and then the connection just kind of like freezes for a second.
Exactly.
That's what happened in my brain. I was just like, I literally don't know what I was doing.
You said, oh, shiny thing. Oh, I'm like, what? What is going on?
I just spaced that. Well, because, like, you know, when you're just sitting around on your own and you just kind of, like, you know, you space out and you make, you know, you're just not paying attention to what you're doing. You're just like, what the hell am I doing?
You know,
you ever do that?
Yeah.
That's kind of what happened.
You like recording in person with me?
Yeah.
I've started to think maybe I don't like it with you, because when we recorded in person in South Dakota, I remembered watching you during that recording and looking at all your tics that you have during a show. I couldn't stand it. Because you fidget and then your feet are pointed in weird directions.
Oh, I move a lot. I move, like, a lot. You don't see anything.
What is he doing? And I forget it every time. Then we were recording together. Like, oh, he's freaking out right now. In some way.
Well, it's not that I'm freaking out. It's just I have undiagnosed ADHD.
Okay.
Speaking of ADHD, we need to get back on track. Any other thoughts on the Villanova Holy Cross game? Look, Villanova, again, they took the week off. They played it like it was a play-in game, and they didn't need to do anything. And I'm sorry, Holy Cross fans, it's not the answer that you wanted. I admit that Holy Cross played well, but I am not admitting that I'm wrong. Villanova was clearly the better team. And if you disagree with me on that, you need to get your eyes checked.
Okay.
Because Villanova picked up some really quick and easy plays when they needed them.
And you can take that to the bank. You hack. You can get your eyes checked. That's coming from a person with glasses. Unbelievable.
Oh, shut. Yeah, with broken glasses. Sean, before I get to any of your takeaways, the other one here, too, that we have to address, the Kennesaw ETSU game. Oh. I literally am perplexed here. I had the game on. I was watching it. And Kennesaw, man, they were just and I had a Kennesaw fan tag me talking about, like, oh, you guys, you know, you got to bring up how dominant Kennesaw looks today and all that. And I saw
that tweet. I'm like, oh, they're running away with it.
They were up by 15 points.
I'm sitting here. Kennesaw called it.
Yeah.
We're going for the chaos. I'm saying, oh, I'm throwing myself a party. I'm seeing tweets.
Yeah.
Oh, Kennesaw's heading on, moving on, Kennesaw, all this. Right. I'm like, good for the boys. I'm happy for Blythe. I'm happy for Nick. I'm like, I still don't text him back, and I should. But I feel like if I texted him, I would have jinxed him. So I couldn't do that. And
you should have texted him.
I'm sitting there. I'm not following. I think I was at work, so I couldn't watch the whole thing. But I'm following on social media. I saw it. I'm like, oh, we got ourselves a playoffs here.
But so I had the game on, and it was like 2 minutes left. They were up by 15, and it ended up being that minute 28 mark when ETSU started to come back. But I had the game on, and I'm like, wow, we really got this one. Kind of like you're saying, I'm like we predict this one pretty right. This is an option team. They're just going to run out the clock. Like, this is a perfect situation for them. And I flipped on the Houston-Cincinnati game for a couple minutes, thinking the game was over. And then I think I flipped to, I think it was North Dakota State SIU for a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm scrolling through Twitter, and I see the score. I'm like, no. Someone's screwing with me. That's not right. There is no way a minute 28 that they came back. ETSU showed the best form of resilience that you need in a playoff. And I can't bet against them anymore. I know that they're facing North Dakota State, but, like, wow, I got a different perspective on them.
My problem is, how far does that carry you, or how long can that carry you? Because I'm not chalking it up to luck, because it's not luck, because you got to go down and score.
Yeah.
But it's one of those sports things where this is going to be a weird statement.
Go for it.
It's God.
We have plenty on this show.
Right? All right,
it's
so God,
is that what you just said?
Yeah. So God, we don't know if he's a sports fan, sometimes you think he might be, and then in these instances, with a 15-point comeback in a minute 28, like, oh, here we go. This is our act. This is our time. Where you're like, oh, that's great, but I wanted that in the national championship. That's how I see huge great wins like this.
Right.
Because you can't burn the good karma too early, but you still have to use it to get there. And I hope I didn't offend everybody or anybody by using God in sports, but that's the way that I see it. It's like, okay, you have your miracles or whatever, and then you move on.
I think the concern of offending people is out the window when you pulled that be a match thing last week.
How was that offensive?
I still can't believe you tried to do that, because you
follow
tried
up.
To, yeah.
They took about a gallon out of me. I saw
that. Was it that bad?
They put in the guy said, all right, this is my first time, but it's all right. I'm not going to mess it up. I say, okay, I'm just going to close my eyes and then just wait for it to be.
Oh, wait, you had a first-timer taking the marrow out.
Uh-huh.
Oh,
wow. He said, I got to get to lunch, but I know how to do this, but it's my first time. I'm like, okay.
Why did you tell someone that? I wouldn't want it. I would, if somebody told me that, I would rather not know that. If you told me that, I'd be like, no, go get somebody else, man. I'm not doing this. You're not going to puncture something. I don't trust you now. I wouldn't trust anyone if they told me that.
I tell you, he got my vein, though, and again, ADHD radio, but...
ADHD.
It's an old ONA line. I don't want to completely steal that or rip that off. But hey, dude, I'm like, all right, so they're going to get the vials. It'll be fine. I look over after it's done. I got like 8 vials full. I'm like, whoa, what did you just take out of me? He said, oh, it's drawing fast too. I'm like, what?
He was eating a sandwich and he forgot to check.
He's like, yeah, I'm about to go. I think he said, yeah, I'm about to go get a sandwich after this. I'm like, this is too casual. I don't like a super formal doctor. Too casual for me.
You didn't get the, oh, we took too much.
No, but I don't know the last time I gave blood or if I have ever. And it was tubes full of my blood.
Sean, they saw you and they're like, oh, we're going to take as much as we can this behemoth.
We can get a liter out of them. Why not?
This will work for like 4 people. Oh, all right, man. Let's get back on track though. Also in wild fashion, this game ends in a 2-point conversion, which is just fantastic to see. You gotta love the balls here to go for two to win the game in this ETSU Kennesaw game. Sean, takeaways for you before I get to any other ones that I have
from the ETSU game or Kennesaw
the whole bracket, because we're not going to hit on every game. I don't think, because some of them are pretty dry, like JMU smacked the crap out of C-Law. Like, how much can we take away from that?
Yeah, JMU looked sharp, or rather, Cole Johnson looked really sharp.
Yes.
I mean, we're not going to really spend much time on North Dakota State. Also, Craig Haley, best article I've read all year on The Analyst with his recap from this last week of the playoffs. It was fantastic. Yes. He had everything we needed. So if you think that we know what we're talking about, we don't, or at least I don't. Follow Craig Haley on Twitter, and he's going to get you all cut up with your real FCS knowledge and
not whatever we
need to know. Yeah. North Dakota State, they rolled Southern Illinois. They didn't look fraudulent, but they kind of did, because we know North Dakota State's not that Trey Lance team or that Carson Wentz team, but they did their thing. Montana State, UT Martin. That's kind of, yeah, I got to hit on that. Tommy Mellott or Mello, Mellott, stepping up for his first career start
in
the playoffs.
Mellott?
I'll go with Mellott. Matthew McKay entered the transfer portal before the game. People were tweeting us before that game happened.
Yeah. Thought it was going to be Rovig.
Really, really weird. That was a weird bit. I guess Mellott is a mobile quarterback. We'll maybe hear his name again later on in the show. That's a pretty cool story to say, hey, you're in, and then you win a playoff game in your first start. I don't know. I guess Montana State fans are pretty hopeful about that. I would be to see that the team has a good enough balance with a backup quarterback to lead them on to victory. But they won pretty handily, so not much more on that. Dude, that Eric Schmidt, Cameron Ward Bowl.
Oh, my God, man. That Eric Schmidt stepped up. And I think that the one thing I've always said about Schmidt is that he's a good college quarterback, but I don't know if I really trust him to take over in these really crucial, important situations. And he proved me wrong in the national championship, but he's been a little bit inconsistent, dealt with some concussion stuff in the middle of the year. And we started to really recognize his importance, but man, that's a big time game right there. I was watching that one. Ramon Jefferson had like a huge run, and that game got me juiced up watching that one. Schmidt though, man, stepped up against Cam Ward. That was a really, really nice battle. And it kind of turned into this Texas style shootout.
Dude, back and forth, 42-42 in the fourth quarter. Crazy. What more could you ask for? I mean, I said it was like, Northern Iowa, playing Northern Iowa is pouring concrete. That game you said it, Texas-style shootout. You're just watching the bullets fly here. He's like, oh, okay. Oh, is the Ranger going down, or is Texas Red going to win here? You know, what's the situation? You just watch them pop off and do all that. Exciting game. Very, very exciting in a week full of blowouts. But I don't know. We had a good enough mix of, I guess, decent games this week, and just from a fan's perspective of it, mm-hmm. not too bad. You got enough excitement, I would say.
Right. The two blowouts that I want to hit on here, Sean, before we transition. I mean, North Dakota State SIU, that one's probably the least amount that we're going to talk about, because it's like, okay, surprise, surprise, North Dakota State's good. They rebounded after the South Dakota State loss. They're a good football team. They're at home. They're going to win football games pretty handedly if they're running the football effectively. But the two that were surprising, and I think the most telling, was JMU smoking C-Law and then EWU getting dominated by Montana.
Well, easy.
That scores.
Dominated is a strong word there.
Because Montana had a bigger lead at one point, and EWU was kind of climbing their way back. Like, it wasn't really like as close as the score looks like it was. And I know that Berrier had a really big stat line, but holy crap, 57 points from that Montana team. Where the hell did that come from?
It's a big number, and I'm not hating, but dominated is a strong word. It's a strong word, Joe.
I don't know, man. I think that to only
give it up 530 passing yards, and you call that domination?
But it's EWU. It's Eastern Washington and Eric Berrier that you're giving those yards up against. I am less concerned about the passing numbers that they gave up, and I am more impressed with the fact that a team that has been pretty mediocre offensively suddenly has this explosive range, and that they can bring that to the table in their upcoming matchup this following weekend.
Well, it's a great matchup between the two, because Eastern Washington's offense is so good and their defense is so, you know, middle of the pack, not so good. And then Montana finally found the way to click. And then in their first matchup, what did Eastern Washington win by? 1 point, 2 points?
Yeah.
We knew it was going to be something like this. I didn't think that the score would be 16 points different, but I mean, good for Montana. Domination is a strong word for me, Joe. I know I'm getting hung up on that.
Yeah, because at one point it was, at the end of the third quarter, it was 20 plus 24 is 44, and it was 44-28, and then they, I mean, like
16 still.
Yeah, actually, maybe I wasn't entirely right on that. Still, 57 points is a lot. The last thing I want to hit on before we get to Fat Stat, Sean, I was very impressed with Cole Johnson. He got brought up on ESPN during one of the, you know, college football playoff conversation shows or Sports Center or something like that for the 6 touchdowns he had. He kind of quelled some of those concerns that I had, because C-Law, as we know, has been really, really good, and I didn't think it was out of pocket for you to pick them to beat James Madison. That was one of those games where I was like, if whoever gets that one right, like I don't think it's really like it's a toss. It was kind of a toss up because of how weak JMU looked against Villanova, the last really good team they played. But Cole Johnson was always the concern, a guy who in the middle of the pack in important situations, not very consistent. And he's made some mistakes, but man, he looked really, really good in this game. I'm a little bit higher on JMU after seeing him play this well.
And a novice listener to this show would think that you're being harsh on Cole Johnson, but I know a good amount of JMU fans in my life, and they have been very split over this season and previous seasons. So it's this is one of the things we're like, okay, we kind of have the people's pulse on this one. So that's a good point. He played well. He played well. And if he can keep doing it, there's been some games this year where you're just like, wow, what a stat. The 23 for 25, 5 touchdowns in the first half, whatever that was. That crazy-ass game where he balled out. Mm-hmm. He's got that potential. He does. And that offense kind of has that potential too. They get a lot of people involved, which is very good if you have the confidence to get that many running backs and wide receivers involved in the offense. Then you're like, okay, cool. We got depth. We can keep people a little more fresh.
Yeah, they'll have some fun in the fun belt. No, but great win for James Madison.
The fun belt.
Yeah, they're moving to the Sun Belt.
You said the fun belt.
Yeah, you've never heard that.
I've never heard it.
You've got Maction and then you've got fun belt. You've never heard of fun
belt? No, I've never heard that.
You are so college football illiterate, it is not even funny. Can you just have some awareness?
You're just illiterate. How about that?
Yeah, I'm socially illiterate. Sean, Fat Stats, you have this is one of the fattest Fat Stat segments I've ever seen. Do we give a Fat Stat?
It's 9 players. It's 9 players. We've done 10 to 12 before. I just won't shed light on the players in college football at the FCS level that are doing well. I just won't do that.
No,
because that's what you want to do.
Screw
that's what you want to do. Because what is the show based on? What is it about? Getting a positive light or just a light on the FCS? We trash numbers. Their social media. We don't, whatever. But look, someone's got to talk about these players because it sure as hell isn't you.
All right, talk about
I'm going to do
talk
it.
Talk about him. Talk about him. God. Talk about him.
Oh, you annoy me. Jeez, what are we on, Fat Stats? Perfect. Let's start this thing off. You got me. Wait, this is a fun, happy segment for me. I enjoy doing this.
I want you to be pissed off. I want you to be angry.
Not for this segment.
Yell at the listeners.
No. They've been very kind, even when pointing out my terrible errors on the show. They're fine with me. I got no beef with the listeners at this moment.
I have beef with them after the way that they went in on me on YouTube and on Twitter. Mostly just Holy Cross fans.
Yeah.
Second time in a row. All right, continue.
What am I saying? Fast ass. All right, let's get this thing going. Villanova linebacker Forrest Rhine this past week had 21 tackles.
Holy crap.
Craig Haley noted that it was double digit in each half. So it wasn't like he just racked up a bunch of the first quarter, kept going, whatever. 21 tackles, 3 tackles for loss, 2 sacks in this game. That's a monster game for him. Let's keep the train moving. Eastern Washington quarterback Eric Berrier, 47 for 80.
I'm praying for that man's arm. I am legitimately praying for the health of his arm. That is too many passes.
47 for 80, just 8-0. 530 yards, 5 touchdowns, 1 interception. Eastern Washington wide receiver Talolo Limu-Jones, 14 catches, 215 yards, 2 touchdowns. So that's pretty good. Number one receiver for that
pretty
team.
Good.
Pretty good. Here we go. JMU quarterback Cole Johnson, 12 for 22. 321 yards, 5 touchdowns.
No, additionally, I didn't see that 12 for 22. I didn't know he threw.
That's not. What is that average? Could you do a little bit of quick maths for me? 321 divided by 12.
Keep talking.
He also had four rush attempts for 44 yards and 1 touchdown. So he was over 360 scrimmage yards, or I think he had 365 scrimmage yards and 6 touchdowns. So that's a pretty fat day, especially in the playoffs.
So he was completed 55% of his passes, which is not good, but 26.7 yards per completion.
God. Oh,
that's pretty gaudy.
That's gaudy. JMU wide receiver
throwing him out of bounds and then just the random 50
I don't
yard.
Know. It's all corner routes. That's all it is. JMU wide receiver Antoine Wells Jr. 6 catches, 123 yards. And 3 touchdowns on the day. Decent. Eastern Tennessee State running back Quay Holmes, 182 scrimmage yards and 3
baller.
Touchdowns.
Baller. Man,
baller.
Don't question Quay Holmes anymore, man. Quay Holmes is going to ball out next week, too. I have no qualms with Quay. Quay deserves some more recognition for being as good of a running back as he is.
Is that just because his pops left a comment on our YouTube channel?
No, I've always spoken very positively of him. I've always spoken very, very positively.
That was a nice comment. He's like, I wonder what they're going to say about him now. And then he also said, like the show. So I think it was just, lighthearted dad response.
Right. We got a lot of dads. A lot of dads. I like that we've got positive dad responses and then angry Holy Cross fans.
It makes me feel like I don't know my audience, though, because we have
all dads, including
the Jackrabbit guys, and then we got the dads all over the place. It's
a dad pod.
You know, my dad's been tracking our predictions on the weekend. He'd be on the call. Oh, you did pretty good on that pick. Oh, you got that one wrong, though. It'll be the phone call.
Has he got a spreadsheet?
No, he's just tracking it. He just does it. It's just a dad thing. Huh?
Thanks, Chris.
Where's
my phone call? I want my phone call for my update on my picks.
You
want
to call my dad? Go ahead.
He needs to call me.
He needs to call. Over. Okay. Every time. This is some nonsense because every time that I've asked to talk to your pops, you're like, no, I can't do it. Or to your,
actually,
you want to talk to my
family.
Your
dad has called me multiple times before. Your dad called me once and I didn't recognize the number. And I'm like, hello, this is Joe. And he's like, can you tell me why Sean's wearing sweatpants to a date? And I'm like, wait, who is this?
That was a tough fit. That was a tough fit.
Jeans on.
Incarnate Word, I did on this last weekend. A little better. A little better. Incarnate Word quarterback Cameron Ward, 39 for 61, not as high as 80, but 61 enough during the regular season attempts. That'll get a note of emphasis. 481 yards and 5 touchdowns this past week in a loss to Sam Houston State. Montana State quarterback Tommy Malote. I don't know where we settled on that.
Malay.
23 rushes, quarterback, 23 rushes, 181 rushing yards, and 2 rushing touchdowns. And then that was paired with Montana State running back Isaiah Ifeanyi, 28 rushes, 176 yards, and 1 touchdown. So just about 400 between the both of them. How are you going to stop that? You can't. Tubbs in the club. Whatever. Cubs.
Oh, he's a freshman too. Mallet. Sorry, I don't mean to get distracted, but he's a freshman. Holy crap. By the way, that's the Idaho State or Idaho pod, the Dubs of the club.
What was the one that we did?
The R&R cast.
Oh, that's the R&R cast. Their Twitter logos are too similar for me.
They're not even close.
Here we go. What am I looking at here? Hold on. The show's wrapping up. I just have to see.
Sheer disrespect.
Hold on.
We're never going to get invited onto a podcast again. Oh, my God.
Okay, I'm seeing the R&R cast.
What was the South Dakota State pod we went on? I know the name. Do you remember?
I think so. Hold on. R&R cast.
No one's going to invite us on anything again.
Tubbs at the club. No, that's pretty similar, bro.
I don't know.
Look at that. That's golden. And you know what? I'll give him a promo, a little plug. Plugola, because we are, I did mess it up.
Plugola. Okay.
And then this. And this was theirs. This was R&R cast. I mean, come on.
Those are not even.
I know, but the yellow. It's the
one
yellow.
One is blue. It's gold. What are you talking about?
Same difference.
You're don't die on this hill. What was the name of the South Dakota State?
Hold on. How come I can't die on this hill?
What was the name of the South Dakota State podcast we went on?
Spittin' Jacks.
Splitting Hairs, and it was the B team pod. Because there's an A
splitting
and a
hairs,
B team.
Spitting Jacks.
Holy crap.
Bidding and splitting. Come on.
Please don't invite Sean onto any more podcasts. He doesn't deserve it. Because I remember the people that we talked to. And I appreciate the opportunity to talk to people.
Brandon McCray. This is worse than the Tyler Cheek bit.
What was the name of the
AQ7 with Brandon McCreary? AQ7 podcast. Yeah, okay. He invited me back. I felt bad about that.
That's disappointing. Why didn't you tell me? I would have hopped on.
I thought he was going to reach out to you.
No, he didn't reach out to me. He was not like me. No, I know he likes me. Or at least I think he does. Yeah, don't invite us on Sean on your podcast. That's going to be it from us, folks. Sean, any closing thoughts? Subscribe, 5-star review.
You can't say closing thoughts.
Subscribe
and then just
on
go right into the, oh,
wait, wait. Subscribe on YouTube, all that good stuff. Sean, anything before we wrap up?
Oh yeah, we'll have a conversation after this.
About what?
You aired me out.
I'm
sitting here trying to take in my FCS knowledge and be really prepared for this show. I set up the doc, and now this is how I get repaid.
You're second in 15 weeks that you've set up the doc and you're all right. I'm sorry. I'm going in on you. Sean's mad at me. All right. We got to address some family matters after this. Drive safe, everybody.
Oh, yeah.
All right.